Well, thank you, Jim. I love it.
I want you to stand and sing with us. The God who evermore will be. He parted prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. Yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out his praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out his praise. Come on, y'all, let's sing. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he wrote. He rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. Yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. Shout out his praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We were forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Come on, let the... Yeah, that's what's up. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Come on, there's joy.
And though my troubles shake me, I know that There's what I want, and then there's where I'm at. Every one step forward got me 5 steps back. And I cry, I call, God knows I pray. Most days faith is climbing up a mountain that's big. Sometimes the only way through it is a hallelujah. Sometimes the only thing to do is just to hand it to ya. And although my troubles shake me, I know they will never move you. Sometimes the only way through it is a hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That's why I say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Doesn't always fix your problems, but it'll tell you how small they are. That's the thing about praise. That's the thing about praise. It won't always move the mountain, but it's good for the heart. That's the thing about praise. That's the thing about praise. You'll never know what it's gonna change, but it'll always leave a mark. That's the thing about praise. That's the thing about praise. Oh, I might see walls start falling, or it might just change my heart. That's the thing about praise. 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 Whoa, sometimes the only way through. Sometimes the only thing to do is just to hand it to ya. And although my troubles shake me, I know they will never move you. Sometimes the only way through it is a hallelujah. That's the thing about praise. You'll never know what it's gonna change. That's why I say hallelujah. That's why I say hallelujah, hallelujah.
Man, I love that song. You know what I love? I love Laura. Isn't she amazing? Amen. I was back there on the side. I'm always just praising Jesus back there. But I was listening to her sing, and I was thinking, wow, she's a mom. Got her kids, and she's always working and doing stuff, and then she has to deal with Jesse in Jesus' name. Thank God you're married to him and not me. I'm just his friend. Praise the Lord. Amen. I just love that, you know, we're just real people doing what we do during the week, and we try to just live for Jesus. Then we come together here to say, let's corporately worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords together. And the song says so much in it, does it not? I love it. That's the thing about praise. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you are a God who gifts his church with very special people that bless our hearts. And there's so many in this house. Thank you, God. Breathe on us, please, today, Lord. So I was just watching Narnia last night, and it was so cool just to watch Aslan just breathe on those people who was all hardened up because of that white witch, and they just... Such a beautiful picture, God. You give us who have hearts of stones, hearts of flesh. You're so good. Do your thing again today, Lord. We'll be careful to praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated and give it up for your band, your production people. Come on, let them know. Let's give them a real clap. Come on, there we go. Amen. Beautiful people serving Jesus. Hey, want to let you guys know that today is our family feast. Amen. And what that means is after the service, we hang out in here, and we partake of yum yum. Amen. And today, we're going to be having some barbecue in this place. William Brothers, they had a little fire. Now they've opened back up. and we're diving in, going to eat some William Brother today. Amen. So I can't wait. It's going to be fun. And what that means is this, is after the service, if you all would, you know, stay in here, hang out. Through those doors right there, there are some tables. And what we're going to do is, if you've not been a part of this before, you just need to know. What we do is we go in there and we grab those tables, we bring them in here, we move chairs, and we set it all up. So at the end of the service, stay in here, help us do that. And then what we do is we go over in here to the Emory room, we get our food, and then we come back in here and we hang out. It's going to be a good time. I'm looking forward to just walking slowly through the crowd and talking to all of y'all. So, and please, whatever you do, give me a hard time. I need one. Amen. I'm always giving people a hard time, so I'm just opening myself up to receive it. Amen. Because I know you're going to do it anyways in Jesus' name. But thank you. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord. And I thank God for what he's doing at Oak Leaf and around our planet. Amen. He is alive and well on planet Earth. You know, we've been leading into the subject of praise. That's why we have this series, The Thing About Praise. And the last couple of weeks, we've seen that the theme of praise is just soaked and saturated all through Scripture. I mean, it's everywhere. Listen to what the Word said. Psalms 145, verse 3. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. Can I get an amen? And his greatness, no one can fathom. Like, you're not going to get and go, okay, well, we've searched the greatness of God and we got to the end of it. No. It's like all of eternity and we still won't scratch the surface of how great he is. And then it says this in Isaiah 25, 1. Oh, Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things. Amen. And we've learned, right? The first week, we learned that when we praise God, he loves to inhabit our praises, and it provokes him to move on our behalf. Remember Jehoshaphat? And he got the praise people in the front of the army, and they just started singing praises, and the next thing you know is the Moabites, the Ammonites, they all got defeated. Amen. God does that when we praise him. He loves praise. He inhabits the praises of his people, and he does wonderful things. And not only the wonderful things that he does on our behalf, but if you just take some time and tap the brakes a little bit and slow down and enjoy creation, you'll see that God has done some wondrous works. Amen. The Duval sent me a video. It might have been yesterday or the day before, I can't remember, but it was pretty cool, of this scientific deal, and scientists have discovered, I wanted to show you the video, but I'd already made a presentation, but it's really cool. They're looking at conception, right? They're watching conception happen in this Petri dish, and all of a sudden, in the middle of this Petri dish, when conception happens, there's a light that happens. There's a light that happens. They're like, what was that? Okay. They're tripping out. And you just got to see the thing. I'll send it out in our leaflet this week. It said, thank you for sending that to me. It just fired my soul up more. I'm like, oh my, like I need it, right? But it's so good. It was so good. So good. So God does wonderful things. Last week we saw the flatworm. You can cut that joker up in five different pieces and it creates new heads and just goes on about its business. Unbelievable. That beetle that was shooting fire out of its booty. What? I mean, come on. Are you kidding me? I mean, it's amazing. It's just absolutely stunning to me. So when this guy says, for you have done wonderful things, I'm telling you, I think that we could live our lives and not even touch maybe 1% of all the wondrous things that are around us, much less when we get to eternity and we start discovering more and more about God. So good. 1 Peter 2:9 says this, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. I want you to turn to the person next to you, look at him right in the face and say, I'm a special possession. Go ahead and tell him that. Go ahead. Come on, do it. Yeah, you go. Some of you ladies looking at your husband like, oh, you're special, all right. Yeah, you are. Yeah, you are. You're God's special possession. And why are we a chosen people? Why are we a royal priesthood? Why are we this holy nation? Why are we a special possession of God? He says why. That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness. You've got a purpose, and a part of your purpose is praise. Amen. Praise, he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Now, if you're thinking that knowing God and living for him is some bygone myth that nobody is leaning into these days, then sadly, you have probably drank the Kool-Aid of America's media. They want you to think that. Nobody's connecting with this Jesus thing. Let's keep all that silent. Let's keep all that low. No, nobody's doing that. They want you to feel defeated. They want you to shroud your praise. Keep silent. Give up on the gospel. Don't do it. Don't do it. God is on the lips of people everywhere. And he's being hailed as famous. God is being praised. This is not some sort of tiny fringe movement. No, the kingdom of God is vast and wide. And people are praising him everywhere. I want you to enjoy this little video I got for you. People praising God. Thanking God.
First and foremost, I have to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for blessing me with the talents to play game.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God, for putting me through what you put me through. But I'm here and I'm happy.
I just want to say thank you so much. Not only to God, but to Jesus.
Hey.
He's really blessed me.
Come on.
He's put me in this position, so I want to say thank you so much.
Both really feel like this award really goes to God.
Chuck Norris's wife.
It's totally been inspired by the Holy Spirit.
Come
and
on.
And we just pray that many millions of lives will be affected by it.
I'd like to thank God for this experience and all my experiences.
Come on,
to thank God for just this experience and for my family.
Glory be to God.
Chance.
I claim this victory in the name of the Lord.
Yeah, he does.
You know, first and foremost, you know, I got to thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
I thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In the power of Jesus, I won this in Germany.
First off, I want to thank God. Because that's who
all
I look
right,
up
all right,
to.
All right.
He's graced my life with opportunities that I know are not of my hand or any other human hand.
I'm up here to say thank you to God for giving me this ability.
Denzel,
for
serious.
Blessing me. For shaping me, for chastising me, for teaching me, for punishing me, for allowing me to be a vessel.
I would not be here with the ease and grace I have in my heart without my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Come on. Thank you. See, listen, belief in God and praising him is not some sort of flash in the pan. This has been the practice of humanity since the dawn of time. And especially since the new covenant with Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise is the superfood of his church. Remember, we talked about that last week. And a superfood doesn't get called a superfood just because it wants to get called a superfood. It is a superfood because people partook of it and it added a certain dimension to their existence. That's exactly what happens as it relates to praise. It's something that the church partook of, they engaged in, and it gave them an edge. It set them up for maximum effectiveness. Listen to how the Bible describes this in the life of the early church. Listen to this. Acts chapter 2, verses 46 through 47, the infallible, inerrant, inspired, authoritative word of God said this: every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God. Say those two words together. One, two, three.
Praising God.
God. And enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord, he always does something when people start praising him, added to their number daily those who were being saved. Amen. I love that. What a benefit praise is. Praising God results in harmony with others. Did you see that? The text says they were enjoying favor with all the people. See, praising people are wonderful people. Praising people are likable people. People who are enthralled with God usually aren't all upset with other humans. Why? We understand that they have a spark of divinity in them. When you praise God, it has an amazing effect on your relationships. It's so powerful. It's right there. And then, couldn't our world use a whole lot more of happiness? I mean, I showed you this picture last week. It's just absolutely ridiculous how angry and mean and nasty it seems like our world is. And by the way, I took a little walk through the store last week and just walked slow and watched people. Is it just me or is everybody just grouchy as all get out? Amen. You say all get out when you're not allowed to cuss. So I just thought I'd say that, right? Are people grouchy like all get out? I mean, come on. I mean, it's just amazing to me. Like, and so I would walk up past people. I was buying a little shirt and some shoes. I walked past people and I was like, hey, man, it's a great day. They're like, blah, blah, blah. What happened to you? I said, man, ain't God good? God good.
I don't know about that.
Well, let me tell you about that. Amen. Well, I'm walking in praise, and so it's so powerful, and I start encouraging other people, and who knows where it's all going to end up, but God is amazing, man. It's a glorious. The thing about praise, it's also one of the greatest evidence that validates the gospel story. The text says this: they were praising God, and the Lord daily added more and more people to the faith family. I think we need to really pay attention to this, especially as churches begin to develop and they begin to grow, because if you're not real careful, you start adding all kinds of things to what you're about in some kind of effort to, I don't know, reach people, minister to people. Okay, well, know that these people didn't go running after people to bring them into the church. They were sharing their faith. They were very active in sharing, but they were praising God. They weren't doing like more and more and more. They didn't have a Bible to study back then. They didn't have it. They weren't doing more Bible studies. They didn't get trained in apologetics. They didn't learn some type of evangelistic presentation. You know what they were doing? God was real to them. They're real to God. They're praising God. And people are watching that. And I'm telling you, there's a supernatural element involved in it where God touches somebody in the heart. And the next thing you know is somebody gets saved. And you don't even know it, but the church is having a testimony service. And somebody gets up and they start sharing their testimony. And then they say, and that person over there was praising Jesus, and it so warmed my heart. I wanted what they had. Have you ever heard that in a story? I wanted what they had. You ever heard that in a testimony? So amazing. I wanted what they had. Well, when the church gets back to praising God regularly, the world will say, you know what? I need what they have. I want what they have, and I need what they have. And we've got it to give. Amen. Amen? This is so good. Billions of people have followed Jesus because the church is a praising church. God is alive and well on planet Earth. I want you to look at this. The question asked by Gallup poll is very revealing about this. God is alive on planet Earth. I started our service with that, right? Well, it's true. It's true. And this question by Gallup poll helps. Americans for years have been asked, did you happen to attend church in the last 7 days? In 2021, 36% said yes. That's post-COVID. 36% said yes. Now, while the media would like for you to think people are bailing and wanting nothing to do with God, pause a moment and think about this Gallup poll. The first time this question was asked was back in 1931. Then 41% people said yes to it. 1939, 41%. So that is, listen, it's only a 5% drop in 82 years, I've got the number wrong on the thing, but 82 years, whereas places like Russia dropped 40%, 40%, Poland 30%, Finland 40%, Denmark 50%. Listen, in over 80 years, only a 5% drop. Are you know what that means? Listen to me. Do not buy the lie of our media. God is alive and well, and millions of people are getting arrested in the gospel of Jesus, and it's changing their lives. Amen. You're here and you're living proof. Amen. It's so good. This is so good. People are praising Jesus still, and you know what he does? When people praise him, he still responds. We're like, I wish God was the God still of the Bible. Praise him. You'll find out that he's still the God of the Bible. Praise him and watch how he flows in the river of your life. It's so beautiful. I love this. Having seen how powerful praise is, it's important to note something about praise. Bringing God praise does not always have to include singing songs. And all the people that don't really like to sing that well said, amen! Or you think you can't sing well, you're like, well, I'd sing that a little louder and I'd go crazy, but I don't want to run people out the room. Amen. It doesn't always involve a song. Sure, it's one major way, but praise is also placed on God when we serve him in his church. Peter, who told us that we are a royal priesthood, whose purpose is to declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his wonderful light, he also says this about praise. If you want to get specific about it, listen to this. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 through 11. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others. Look at me. You have a gift. God placed, look at prayer at me real quick. God placed in you, the moment you got saved, he gave you a gift. And you just read Corinthians and you'll find out there, you are gifted. Read Romans, you are gifted. God placed a gift in you, listen, that nobody else can do. Now, they might share a same gift in this, but they won't do it quite the way that you do it. You're a unique individual that God placed on this planet because he's got a plan and a purpose for you. You are God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus under good works that he foreordained that you should walk in them. You are a unique person that God has placed on this planet, and he gave you a gift, and we are to use that gift for the glory of God. Most people don't really know what their gift is, or they're serving in an area that's not really their primary gifting. But they, you know, that, well, this is what I'm doing. But if they ever had the chance to go explore different places to serve, maybe in exploring several different places to serve, they would find that one place that, like, oh, this is my niche. This is where I feel like I really, 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 really fit in. You have a gift. Whatever gift he has received, serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. Did you see that? To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Did you see it? Peter says, serve. Why? So that God may be praised through Jesus Christ. Serve and praise Jesus. See, let me tell you, there is some serious, serious praising going on here at Oak Leaf Church. I'm talking about some serious praising, amen. We got some serious praising going on at Oak Leaf Church. Matter of fact, check this picture out. We got a bunch of them. That's Dave and Lori. They're right there. That's Dave and Lori. They bring God great glory through serving at our church as our care group, church at home group directors. They watch over that ministry. They're fanning the flame of that ministry, and they're bringing God great, great glory. This one is Levi and Morgan. Love them, amen. I don't know who the lizard is, but I, you know, bring them to church, that's fine. But they bring God great glory because they're serving God in our youth ministry, amen. Amazing how God's raising up young generation. So I'm telling you, this thing ain't over, people. The world will tell you that everybody's turning away from God. That's not true, amen. God is alive and well. They're serving in our church. This is Fernando. I love my brother Fernando. He is our passionate minister. Yeah. He is our passionate minister to our Hispanic community. God is doing great things through English as a second language, and we have great hope for many, many other marvelous things to be happening in the future. But Fernando, you're bringing God great glory. This is Hannah and Nathan. Hallelujah. Amen. He is our youth minister here at our church. Praise the Lord. And she is our children's minister, and they bring great glory to God. Amen. They are so amazing. I love them. Plus, if you ever need a tidbit of information, just ask Nathan. He's got a bunch of it. It's really good to hear. Oh, and by the way, I don't know if you know these two people, but this happens to be Jesse and Laura. I'm in so much trouble. You guys are like, now I know why you said that nice thing about Laura earlier. Jesse and Laura, they really are super worshipers for Jesus. I was thinking about, since I've been here, I've not had one moment where I've ever had to call them on a Saturday or Sunday or anything and say, hey, where are you? They're just always here. You know what they're doing? Praising God. And they're bringing great glory to Jesus Christ. Amen. But I need those outfits on you next week, by the way. Amen. And of course, this is Shonda and Tom, and Shonda and Tom are back there in the back, and they're gathered. Yeah, go ahead, give it up. They're back there in the back, gathered around all the computer stuff because they're casting it online for us, and they bring God great glory by serving on our production team. They're absolutely amazing. Love them so much. And this here is Brother Nate. He's our agent of worship, Mr. Nate. He serves on our worship team. Great brother in the Lord. Love him. What I'm trying to tell you is that there's some great praising going on at Oak Leaf. I'm just trying to tell you that. Beautiful people serving Jesus in a powerful way. And then here's David. David is our sound ninja. That's what I call him. He's our sound ninja. Serving Jesus, going at it, loving man. He's such a great warrior. And you know what I love too is that every one of these people, they all got stuff going on that could possibly render them excusable from coming to church. I had this horrible thing happen in my life. Totally understandable. I get it. I would never browbeat anybody upside the head, get them to come to church. You know why? Because you don't have to. Because if people have a personal relationship with God, all hell can break loose in their life and overseas, and people love them, people help them, and then they get that grip back onto God, and then the next thing you know is they're serving Jesus and bringing great praise to God. And it inspires me, man, to wake up and keep going at it for the glory of God. I love, love, love our team here. And then we have Billy and Shay, and Shane, and they're amazing. I love Billy and Shane. They're just beautiful people serving in security and hospitality warriors is what they do. Amen. I just saw Billy trying to get something out of the room there, and she put that little stool up and walked up, and I was like, "You need me to get that?" She goes, "I got it." I'm like, "Yeah, you do." Amen. Billy, don't play around, did you? And then these are just Jesus fanatics at a church at home group. Amen. Acting crazy and going nuts. Look at them. There you go. I love it. I love it. And see, that's what they do. You know what they're doing? They're serving Jesus by serving each other in a church at home group. Powerful, powerful stuff. Really good stuff. This is Jessica and Ray. I don't know who that guy is in the middle, but I think he tied the knot. But we're serving on our worship team and serving in security. He has longer hair now and looks more like Jesus, which that's what Jessica does for people. Amen. Makes him more like Jesus. I love that. Love it, love it, love it. And then this is Rodney. He's our one need hero. Amen. Jesse could tell him that I did this. I put it up here. He's going to hate me for it. That's awesome. He is one need is such a powerful ministry that's making such a big difference for the glory of God. They're amazing. Next, we have on the slide our dignified and dashing Royal Brooke and Jeff. Yeah, baby, come on now. They are our Oakleaf MVPs. Look at them, amen. I can't figure out in that picture if Jeff's letting Brooke hold his hand or is Brooke letting Jeff hold her hand. I don't know, but it's one or the other. It's one or the other. They're beautiful people. Love it. They're amazing. And then we also have our elderettes. I call them elderettes. They're absolutely the pearl brigade. They serve our faith family, and they bring great glory to God. If anything is ever going on and you guys need to be ministered to, I know that these teams of ladies are going to be there, and you will not be alone. Amen. Powerful ministry. Praise. I'm trying to tell you, there's some serious praising going on at Oakleaf. Amen. And then we have our elders themselves. There's three of them there, and then I happen to be a little bit mixed in the mix there. But a great team of men. They are not yes men. These guys love Jesus, serve Jesus, challenge me, inspire me to live for the glory of God. And anytime, any moment, anywhere, I know you ever go through anything, they're a phone call away. And I don't have to worry about it. They are serving Jesus and bringing great praise to God. And then we have Jim and Judy Culpepper. I love Jim and Judy Culpepper. They are my friends from way back. I tied the knot with them, too. It was pretty cool. Did their little wedding a long time ago. And they live up north, about an hour north. They come here every Sunday, but their home on the mountain is always open to people. They're always hosting events, doing Jesus gatherings at their house. You ask anybody up there on their mountain, and they'll tell you, oh, yeah, Jim and Judy, they're crazy about Jesus. Amen. They are fanatics about Jesus. And they're always bringing people to come to church, like all the time. They're all the time. We got Jason and Lorena. They always bring people to church, too. You got Jim and Judy. Always. You got right there. These brothers right here sit next to them. And then bringing great praise to God. Amen. And then, of course, you guys have a pastor that you can be very proud of. There he is right there. Amen. I looked for a picture that was the closest one I could find that matched my hairdo there. That's awesome. Oh, I love it. As I studied this week about the power of praising God through serving, my mind went back to 1989 when I first got saved. I had just come straight out of the party surf culture and crowd in Jacksonville, Florida. And I got radically saved. I mean, I met God, like met him, February 24th, 1989, in a Chevy S10 truck at 8210 Free Avenue. He showed up and sat down inside that little white Chevy S10 truck. I mean, arrested my heart. The thing I remember most that happened in that moment is my dad used to always beat me and tell me that he wished he would have never bought me for $200. I was adopted for $200. Like a little Walmart special, amen. And my dad used to always tell me he wished he'd have never bought me for $200. He'd run around the house drunk, looking for the receipt, slamming stuff, and putting his finger in my face saying, "I'm looking for the receipt. When I find it, I'm taking you back." And I probably gave him plenty of reasons to act something like that, but that was a little over the top if you ask me. I got saved, and I'll never forget, God spoke to me in that truck. And he said, Tony, your dad discouraged you by telling you that he wished he would have never bought you for $200. But I'm your heavenly father, and I want to tell you something. I've never regretted purchasing you with the priceless blood of my son. Amen. God rest my heart. I mean, he saved my soul. Saved my soul. And then it's just been a journey with him ever since. And part of that journey was the church that reached out to me. They had a Friday night Bible study, which was a lot like this. And then they had Sunday morning big church. And Sunday morning big church, they had the organ, you know, and the choir with the little robes, and everybody came in. And I'm telling you, there was a major clash of cultures that happened. Party scene, I come from. Next thing you know, I'm coming to this church. It was a Southern gospel singing, Southern Baptist, King James only. Deacon ran, deacon scrutinizing everything he did. Crazy church. Like, it was crazy. It didn't take, I mean, I'm enjoying Jesus, right? I'm coming in, I'm clapping during the songs. People are like, no, we don't clap. I'm like, oh, okay. What do you mean you don't clap? And then songs would be up, and I'm up on my chair. I'm like Ron, up on my chair, like, woo! Just praising God, having a big time in Jesus. People literally people would come up to me all the time and say, what's wrong with you? What is wrong with you? Preacher would be preaching, right? I remember Harold Hudson, Hollering Harold. He'd preach, and I'd scream. He'd say something like, I don't know, live for God. God loves you. He's going to care for you. And if you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these things will be added to you. And I'm like, amen. Like, woo, God said that. Every head in the church. I'm like, what? Did I just do something wrong? I don't know what I did. There was a major clash of cultures. It's like, that's not what you do here. And I was so on the edge of just quitting. So I was like, I don't know. This is not the same as the Jesus I'm reading about in the Bible. Like, they just try to put me in this little compartment that's called a Christian. And please, Oak Leaf, don't ever turn into that in Jesus' name. I won't ever lead us into that world, that's for sure. But it was happening to me. And I was almost quitting. And I was spending $30 on a taxi one way to go from Sin City, my little ghetto neighborhood, to get over to Westside Baptist Church in Jacksonville, Florida, so I can go to church on Sundays. $30. Then I just figure out how to get home. And God would always work it out. It's pretty cool. But I one of the reasons I'd spend $30 wasn't just to go to the whole church thing, because they were hating on me. Here's why I did it. This guy, Jim Law, good man. He was the music minister at this church that I got saved at. And he'd stand in front of the church, and I'd come in, and he'd be out there. And this is what he said. First Sunday I saw him. Tony Nolan, it's good to see you. You think, well, that's not like, pow, wow, woo. That really touched me to hear it, Tony. Now, it's really important when you understand what everybody used to say to me. Tony Nolan, what are you doing here? You're not welcome. I was white trash from Sin City. Wasn't invited anywhere. Nobody ever said that. Matter of fact, Tammy and I were talking, and I told her this morning, my dad never said, good to see you. Never heard it come out my dad's mouth. Here's a guy in the front of the church wearing his little cool suit. Jim Law. I'd come in. Tony Nolan, good to see you. That radically altered me on the inside. Why I'd spend that $30 just to get there again? Because this guy was breathing life into my, he was serving Jesus and breathing life into my soul. It was powerful. That one personal touch, it enabled me not to quit. I didn't quit coming to church. I ended up surrendering into ministry. I went out to school, studied for ministry. And then now, all of these years later, that was 30-something years ago when Jim said that, hey, how you doing? Tony Nolan, good to see you. And now we can look back. My board of elders did it when we had our board of directors for our ministry TNT. Before we came here, they did a little spreadsheet on our ministry, and we've seen over 1 million people come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior through the preaching ministry that God had called me to. 1 million people. Documented. Crazy stuff, right? God really used Jim in a powerful way in my life. Imagine if I'd have quit. But just one guy out there serving. Tony Dolan, good to see you. See, that's why I'm not really interested in bells and whistles in a church. I think the thing is when human beings get connected with God and they praise God, even though when they're going through hell in their life, they praise God, they're enjoying Jesus, and then they breathe that into the heart of somebody else, man, that has retainment value. That has get in the family value. That has power on it. That I'm all these years later, and I feel so strongly about it. It's so amazing to me. So when I think back of a model of praising God by serving, Jim's example, its personal influence on my life comes to the top of the list. What a great man. He recently celebrated 50 years in ministry. And so I'm thinking of him, and he came to my mind about this. You know what he would do too? He was a music minister, so he sang. And he had this big, deep baritone voice, like that guy that used to sing with Billy Graham, you know? That deep George Beverly Shea guy, deep voice. And he sang a song, and I want to read you the words from this song. I had never heard it until he sang it, and it so moved my soul. But listen to this. I will serve you because I love you. You have given life to me. I was nothing until you found me. You have given life to me. Heartaches, broken people, ruined lives are why you died on Calvary. Your touch is what I longed for. You have given life to me. Jim sang that song like that. I've got a little something that I want to share with you that going to make you Bereans, you Bible study people, a little giddy. Amen. I want to make y'all happy a little bit, because sometimes I know my videos don't do that. But here we go. I got a little something I'll share with you. It's a little something that I picked up along the way. I want you to listen. Serving and serving only to bring God praise is very powerful. Several years ago, I had the opportunity to speak at a conference for pastors, and it was a conference that Jim was co-hosting. There's 500 plus pastors at this thing, and he invited me and some others invited me to come speak to these guys during this three-day thing that they were at. And so I did, and I got up to address them, and when I got up to address them, I asked them a question. I started by asking them to describe their ministry in just one sound. 500 pastors, can you describe your ministry in one sound? Like, maybe it's the sound of clashing swords. I don't know. Maybe it's the sounds of bells ringing, church bells. I don't know. Maybe it's the sound of exploding grenades. I don't know. You know, describe your ministry in a sound. So, and then I gave them some time as they feverishly wrote down their responses. And when they were finished, they all were looking up at me, and I asked a question. I said, did any of you pick the sound? Did any of you pick the sound? There were no hands. There was a lot of this. Like, what? Did you say that again? Anybody? Did you describe your ministry with that sound? Nobody. Nobody in the room. And then I informed them that that's the way Paul would have described his. Matter of fact, he did that in Philippians 2:17. Listen to it. Paul writes, he said, yes, and if I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. Now, two things about this verse that I want you guys to lean into. First of all, he's not talking about dying here in Philippians 2:17. A lot of people say that. Even a lot of commentaries will say that. No, he talked about dying later in 68 A.D. This was a little bit earlier. Pay attention, Bereans, my Bible study friends. Listen carefully. He talked about death when from a prison cell awaiting beheading, he writes in 2 Timothy 4, verses 6 and 7, for I am already being poured out as a drink offering. See, a lot of people tie those together because he uses the phrase drink offering, but no, listen to what he says. And the time of my departure is at hand. See, this man is dying. I have fought the fight, the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. See, that's the language of a dying man. But in Philippians 2:17, he's not talking about dying. He's talking about his ministry. So listen carefully, my little Bereans. You may, like the pastors did when I said it, ask the question, when did Paul call his ministry a in those verses? Now here's where my little Bible study people are going to get real giddy. Back in the days before Calvary, offerings were big ministry. Burnt offerings particularly. Check out this picture. See, a big old bull would be placed on this massive grill and would go up in the flames. And you've got incredible stuff going on. The bull's placed on a barbecue. Oh yeah, we're gonna have a family feast. Don't forget about that. After this is over, we're gonna go through those doors, grab those tables, bring them in here, and we're gonna enjoy some barbecue. Gonna get an amen. Amen. We're gonna get it on. But say barbecue, this is happening. People from miles away could see the smoke from this bull burning. Looking toward the temple, they would see the smoke and they would think, there's big ministry going on right there. Miles and miles away. They say over 15 miles away, because that's the standard meridian of the curvature of the earth. People could see it 15 miles away. Smoke going. And they would look toward the temple and go, big ministry going on over there. And most people scratch and joust for big burnt offering ministries. It's huge. It's essential. And it's well praised by other people. But that's not what Paul thought of his ministry. He said his ministry was a drink offering, not a burnt offering. Pay attention. Now, what is a drink offering? Would be different sizes based upon what they're going to pour this thing on. The size of a drink offering depended upon what it was going to be poured on. And the bull offering would be 2 quarts of wine. And it was poured directly on the burnt offering. At best, the only one who saw it or knew that it happened was the priest who poured it on the burning bull. One quick toss into the inferno, and all that happened was a very quick, that's it. Like water poured on a hot grill, in a millisecond, it's over. Only those close enough could hear the quick sizzle of the wine hitting the heat and then evaporating. Nobody saw it from 15 miles away. Nobody saw it from 2 feet away. That's what Paul thought of his ministry. Small and inconsequential compared to other ministries. Remember, he said he was the least of the least. Paul had no idea the real extent of his ministry. He did not know that he would be canonized into Scripture and we would be reading his letter 2,000 years later in America. He had no idea that that was going to happen. He thought it was nothing more than a brief, my ministry is just a drink offering. The bull offering, that's a big thing. I'm just a mission trip after mission trip and church plant after church plant. He just kept being poured out. But oh my, looking back now, we can see what great impact the Apostle Paul had. Listen, just like Jim had no idea the influence of his handshake and affirming words would have in my life. I was about to quit, but he was faithful to serve. It's been 30 years since that handshake and affirmation. And I surrendered, did all of that. And now we see, looking back, over 1 million people came to know Jesus. See, now Jim, because he's going to listen to this link of this thing this week, I'm going to send it to him. Yeah, I guarantee he's going to think, wow, I had no idea that a handshake and an encouraging word would go so far. Well, I don't know. I mean, I come to church and I'm just not so sure. I mean, I just don't know that it's for me. Hold on. Wait a minute. No, let church be for others and you'll be surprised how much it becomes so good for you. It's so powerful. Anyone who serves, You have no idea just how powerful your act of service will be on someone else knowing. And knowing this is immensely fulfilling. When you know that you do something and it changes people's lives, it is so fulfilling. Check out that little map. Isn't that something? Like a little treasure map. Those people trying to figure it out. Where is that treasure? Then you see it. It's just falling on his knees, praising God, giving God great glory. Would you guys stand with me, please? Pew Research interviewed Christians from across America and discovered that those who say they are fulfilled Christians, meaning they have a deep inner satisfaction about their faith, were the ones who had a place of service in the church. Do you see that there in the bottom of the little deal? Pretty powerful. It's a pretty powerful deal. People that have a deep inner satisfaction about their faith were the ones who had a place of service in the church. Those who did not serve reported dissatisfaction and disconnection. Wow. Isn't that interesting? I mean, why would it blow our minds? Jesus said, you get by giving. You're first by being last. What? You live by dying. It's the paradox of Christianity. You want this to be greater? You want deeper fulfillment in your soul? Find a place of service. Start serving Jesus. Well, I could serve God somewhere else. Well, okay, we'll do that then somewhere else extra. Serve his church. Jesus died for his church. Jesus is coming back for his church. His church matters to him. It's called his bride. And we are a part of the church of Jesus. And there are great things happening collectively if all of us serve together for the glory of God. Oh, my goodness. There are some powerful things happening for the kingdom. It's in a big way. So here's a little something that I want to invite us into for the month of May. I'm inviting you all on a wonderful treasure hunt. I call it Maybe May. Maybe May. Well, if they can do No Shave November, then why don't we do Maybe May? Amen. Maybe May. Maybe May. What do you mean by May? Well, the pilgrims came over in the Mayflower. They didn't know what they were doing. But if you read that little Mayflower compact and all the things that we're saying, then one of the things they wanted to do was serve God. And they served God by serving each other. And there was great power in that. And then think about the history of that. And they came here. And yeah, we got a lot of things we got to work through in America, but think about it. In over 80 years, there's only been a 5% drop in people attending church. This is still a breadbasket of the gospel for the world. And God's blessing, God's moving. We're being stewards of the move of God. And it's happening globally. And this is powerful. And think about what God is doing through Oakleaf. We have our part to play for the glory of God. And so here's what I want to encourage you to do. Maybe May. If you don't have a place of service at our church, here's what I want to invite you into. You want a more fulfilling walk with God? You would like to have more of an inner, God, this thing in me and God is like growing and invigorating. Serve Jesus. Serve God here at Oakleaf Church. Maybe in May, pick one place to serve and see what happens. Like we need people to help in our children's ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. We need help at our coffee bar, our greeter hosts, safety team, student ministry, Roots that meets on Sunday nights. They could use help. We have our Oakleaf team that's welcome to Oakleaf. They need help. And our worship and production could always use help. So here's how you do it. Get started on the journey through the next little slide that's coming up. It's right there. See that little QR code? You could take your phone out and you could click that and register now. And you register, and when you register, there are places to serve. Take your phone out, and you do that, and you do it on your phone. You go to Planning Center. And by the way, I want us to leave that up after the service while people are in here eating. We'll leave that slide up if we can, Alex, after we're done. Leave that up. That way they can still do that. You also have a couple of these in the seats around you, and you can do that QR code there. And what I want to encourage you to do is, during the month of May, don't just pick one place to serve in. Explore several places to serve in. And then you'll find, as you serve, like say, I'm going to serve at three different places. Then at the end of the month of May, maybe May, at the end of May, you go, wow, I have found that this particular place, whatever it is, maybe it's children's ministry. I feel so invigorated by this. I'm pouring into little kids, and God's doing great work in their life. Everybody that serves back there with the kids comes back with two things. Number one, a headache in Jesus' name, amen. And then number two, a smile with a headache. Who gets that? People that know they just gave little children the bread of life. And they know that God blesses the touch. Oh, we don't see it right now, but I'm telling you, God does not waste our investment. If I can look back 30 years and get choked up because a guy in a suit holding a King James Bible looked at me and said, Tony Nolan, so good to see you. Man, I'm telling you, it's touched and anointed by God when you serve. And our thing is show up, serve. As you do, you'll experience fulfillment. And then the kingdom of God had advanced for the glory of God. I mean, think about it. Think about this. Life as we know it one day will not be like it is. Hallelujah. One day it's going to be all over. And what we can do for Jesus, then, too late. Now's the time. Today is the day. Paul said, wake on the righteousness, sin not, for some don't know God. There should be some urgency. We've got one brief moment to share and to serve, and then all of eternity to celebrate, dance at the feet of King Jesus, and just go nuts. But now, serve. And isn't it wonderful that we get to do it, and when we do, we're fulfilled? Somebody asked me, Tony, why are you not out there traveling anymore, going to all those big events and doing all that big stuff? Come to my event. Come on. Come to my event. I've said no, I don't know how many different people. Well, what are you doing? I am fulfilled. I am deeply in my spirit fulfilled. I believe that I'm in a lane that God supernaturally put me right where I'm at. And my wife and I have not been happier in our souls in so long. And it's so fulfilling, isn't it, babe? She's back there. Hallelujah. Amen. I mean, it's just so good. So I'm happy to be in the journey with you. And I want to encourage you, the QR code, do it. Do that. You'll have time to do it later after we praise God in song and enjoy Jesus. But think about what's going to happen for the glory of God. Amen? So good. Let me pray for us. Father God, you're so good. We thank you, God. I praise you, God. You are alive and well on planet Earth, and Satan doesn't stand a chance. You are doing all that you are doing for your glory. And in the media, the world, they're crazy. They don't get it. We do. We understand. We believe. God, thank you for what's happening at Oak Leaf. Thank you for this invitation to praise you. And we are going to do it through service to you. And God, now, as we have listened to you and listened to your word, we thank you, God, that you've called us out of darkness into your wonderful light, wonderful, marvelous light. And God, we praise you. And as we praise you now in song, God, hear us. And may we in this moment spread a massive smile across your beautiful, gorgeous face, sweet Jesus, because you're worthy of it. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Normally in this part of the service, we bring you down a little bit, right? But we're not going to do that today. So me and my wife have this banter. Every time Tony opens a little of his story to us, she's like, waterworks. Look, just crying. I look over at her and I smile, and she's like, you have the heart of the Grinch. What is wrong with you? But for me, it was much like when my kids were born and all these things that happened. There's just joy when I hear the story, when Tony shares the story. I hear praise. I hear a celebration because I see my friend and how he's walking in the light with Jesus the way he needs to. And that's something to praise. So I know that a lot of us have gone through things that are painful. And sometimes it's hard to do and say, Lord, we praise you. But we need to just do it. And hopefully our heart will follow our actions. I struggle with that personally. Like my actions have to lead my heart, because like my wife says, it's like the Grinch, right? So my actions have to lead my heart. But every time I allow that to happen, Lord softens my heart and allows it to follow the actions that he tells me to be faithful to. So this morning, we're going to praise. Let praise be the weapon that silences the enemy. Come on. let praise be the weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing in your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all that we are and we claim your victory. Let it rise. Let praise arise. Come on.
We see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift you high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh,
come on. Let faith be the song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. And let it rise. Let faith arise. Yeah.
We see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift you high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh.
We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. We praise you, come on.
This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. We cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift you high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh.
Band, just stay on the one here. Sing this with me. I can hold my praise. I'm gonna let it out. I can hold back my praise. I'm gonna let it out. I can hold back my praise. I'm gonna let it out. Can't hold back my praise. I'm gonna let it out. I can't hold back my praise. I'm gonna let it out. I can't hold back my praise. I'm gonna let it out. Come on. I can't hold back my praise. I'm gonna let it out. See you break down every wall. We watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift you high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. We
You're never gonna let me down.
Don't we know it, Lord?
You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down.
Our God is faithful.
You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down.
Oh, Lord.
You're never gonna let me down.
Oh, my God, Lord. You're never gonna let me down. 'Cause you are good. You're good, yes. Oh. You are good, you're good, oh.
Oh,
From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands, for I am yours.
Yeah, yeah. Y'all give it up for Jesus. Come on now. Praise the Lord. So good. What we're going to do is I'm going to pray for us. I'm going to pray over our meal that we're about to have some barbecue up in here. Amen. I'm looking forward to it. And remember, stay in this room. We need your help. Right on the other side of those doors right there are tables and chairs and all that. We'll dive in. You guys know this bill. You've done it before. We're so grateful. This is one of my favorite things that we do. I love hanging out with y'all. And then we don't have to go to a restaurant. Praise Jesus. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you. I was in the back, and as I was singing the part about you, never let me down. There's some great wrestling that happens inside my soul when I sing those words. Because there's been lots of disappointment, lots of surprises, lots of what? But God, it's so true. Jesus, you said that I'm in your hand and no one can shake me out of it. And that I'm in the Father's hand and no one is able to shake us out of the Father's hand. So really in the end, when we stand before you face to face, well, we're going to be able to sing that with such amazing abandonment. And tears, no doubt, that you're going to just have to wipe away. So good, God, that you do hold us. Thank you, God, that we're yours. I mean, we're your special possession. Wow. How valued and treasured are we, God? You bestow on us that. It's so good. You're good. And God, if we don't jump up on a rooftop today and start screaming your name, it's all right. We'll do it from our porch, from our street, maybe our driveway, cubby at work. Just everywhere we go, let that be on our lips. God is good. You are good, and you're greatly to be praised. Thank you, Father, for this faith family and what you're doing. We are amazed at your activity. We thank you, God, as I made a little video this morning, and I sent it to our former pastor, Will. What a joy to know that you've been working here for so many years, through so many lives, and you have not abandoned this place. You are good and you're awesome. We thank you for all those who have served over the years, and God, those who are with us now, locking arms, advancing your kingdom. You're worthy of it, God. You're so worthy. Thank you for this food we're about to eat. We pray your blessings on it, and then God, help us to be an encouragement to everybody in this room. Help us to speak words of life and encouragement and caring for one another. And we thank you for everybody who worked hard to get this food here. Bless, Lord, for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God together said, amen, amen. One more time, give it up for Jesus. Come on.